All right. Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Deepthi Behl, and I would be talking about one of the methods or one of the best methods for first trimester abortion, and that is going to be suction evacuation. I'm primarily going to, stick to the steps of suction evacuation, which is very, very important as far as undergraduate professional exams are concerned, as well as postgraduate entrance exams are concerned. We've tried to keep the approach a visual approach, so I'm going to give you things that you need to know about different steps, and such that you retain them for a longer time, right? So we're going to start with the steps or procedure for the process of suction and evacuation. Now, as far as the MTP Act of India is concerned, the procedure of suction evacuation can be done up till 12 weeks of period of gestation, right? In the first 7 weeks, we can do the medical methods, and from 7 to 12 weeks, this is the best method for first trimester abortion. Usually, when we begin with suction evacuation, we would administer the patient with pre-operative antibiotic prophylaxis, and usually the anesthesia that we give for the procedure is a light IV sedation, right? Following which, the woman is going to be put in the dorsal lithotomy position. Now, dorsal lithotomy position is important, so I want you to look at the visual, and then to also understand a couple of things that I want to insist on. I want you to focus on, one, the popliteal fossa, right? So the popliteal fossa should be free, right? So it should not be compressed, such that we avoid compression of the sciatic nerve. That's the first point. The second point, the medial aspect of the lower leg should also be free, or it may be padded, and this is done to avoid compression of the saphenous nerve. So that's with the medial aspect of the lower leg. Then the lateral aspect of the lower leg should also be free or preferably padded. Now this is done to avoid compression of the peroneal nerve, right? So this is important when we take care of the lithotomy or the dorsal lithotomy position for the patient. Now, once we have put the patient in the dorsal lithotomy position, we are going to do a bimanual examination. Now, this is done to determine a couple of things. First would be cervical dilatation. Second, we definitely want to know the position of the uterine fundus, whether it is antiverted or it is retroverted. And very, very important, we want to know or have an estimate of the uterine size. Following this, we are going to prepare the vulva, the perineum and the vagina with betadine. We must empty the bladder, so we would use a metal catheter for that. And then we are going to drape the patient under all sterile precautions, right? So this is how we are going to drape the patient for this procedure. Following these things, we place the speculum in the vagina to visualize the cervix. Once you visualize the cervix, the anterior lip of the cervix should be held. Now, since we're talking about a pregnant cervix, a better instrument to hold the anterior lip of cervix is going to be a sponge holding forceps or the ring forceps. Otherwise, a single tooth tenaculum can also be used for the purpose, but please remember that the tenaculums are traumatic. So sponge holding forceps are better instruments when it comes to holding the cervix in pregnancy, right? Now, once we hold the cervix, we are going to give a paracervical block. Now, this is important again. The paracervical block is usually given at 2 points. And as you can see in the picture here, the points are going to be 4 o'clock position and the 8 o'clock position. So why do we choose these positions? Because at 3 and 9 o'clock positions, there are descending cervical arteries. So we do not want to give the anesthetic agent intra-arterial. So we're going to give it at the mucocutaneous junction between the cervix and the vagina at 4 and 8 o'clock position. We would usually use 10 ml of 1% lidocaine on each side, right? So that is what is used to perform the paracervical block. Following this, we are going to perform a uterine sounding. Now, the sounding is an important step because it gives us again a confirmation of the direction of the uterus, antiverted and retroverted, and could be an important step to avoid perforation. The uterine sound also acts one of the first dilators. Also, I understand that we might want to know from you the difference between a uterine sound and a bladder sound. And two of the most important things to identify a uterine sound are that this instrument is graduated, which means it has markings on it. And these graduations are going to be absent on a bladder sound. The second way to differentiate these two instruments are that the uterine sound is actually angulated. So it is angulated at the end. Whereas a bladder sound is not angulated. It has a very gradual curve, but not an angulation. So those are the two things that help us to identify the uterine sound. And as I said, it is important to confirm the position of the uterus in order to avoid injuries like perforation. Now we're going to choose the suction cannula. The suction cannula that we use in our setups in India is going to be a Karman's cannula that's on your screens right now. Now, how do you choose what suction cannula are you going to use? So one, we can decide on the basis of gestational age. So we would usually take a Karman's cannula, which is one less than the gestational age. For example, if the gestational age is 12 weeks, we could use a 10 weeks Karman's cannula. Or once you've done a bimanual examination, you know what the size of the uterus is. So you could also use it corresponding to the size of the uterus in your examination. So please remember, if you're considering the period of gestation, take it one less than that. If you're taking the size of the uterus as per your examination, then the cannula should correspond to the size of the uterus. So once we decide what cannula we are going to use, the next we are going to bring about cervical dilatation. Now the instrument that we use here is called as the Haggar's dilator, and I very importantly want you people to focus on the position in which we are holding the Haggar's dilator. The Haggar's dilators are again curved instruments, they are blunt on either side, and they have to be typically held in a pen holding manner. The reason we hold it in a pen holding manner is that we do not cause uterine perforation, right? And the two ends of the Haggar's dilators are again graduated, which means one end would do one graduation or dilatation, the other would do the next dilatation, right? Now, once you have dilated the cervix, we are going to introduce the cannula into the uterus. Now, what are the important things that you have to understand here? See, the cannula has been connected to the hosing of the suction machine. When you are introducing the cannula into the uterus, the machine should be switched off. The machine should be switched on only once you are inside the uterine cavity, right? Now, when you are inside the uterine cavity, we are going to move the cannula around 360 degrees inside the uterus till all the products have been evacuated. So, which means we need to know what is the end point of suction evacuation. Usually, these are the three things that we are going to focus on. So, number one, the amount of products that we start seeing in the cannula is going to reduce. Number two, the bleeding will also reduce. And number three, instead of tissues, air bubbles will actually start appearing in the suction cannula. So these are the three points that tell us that we have reached the end point of suction and evacuation. Now, once you are completed the process of suction and evacuation, the next thing is going to be a check curettage. A check curettage is done with a uterine curette that is on your screens now, and we are going to do a sharp curettage when we are doing a check curettage, right? Now, the sharp curettage is done to ensure that we remove all the products of conception from the uterine walls. So again, we should know what is the end point of our curettage. The end point of curettage is going to be a gritty feeling on the curettage, because now you are directly curetting on the walls of the uterus. There is no tissue intervening between the curette and the uterine wall. So it starts giving you a gritty feeling. So that is the end point that tells us that all the products of conception have been removed. Please remember, excessive curettage should be avoided. Why? Because excessive curettage can lead to development of intrauterine adhesions, which is described as Asherman's syndrome. So the picture on your screens now is a hysteroscopic view of the uterus, which has intrauterine adhesions or the Asherman's syndrome. Once you finish the procedure, all the products that you have removed should be sent for histopathology. You remove the sponge holder from the anterior lip of cervix, remove the speculum, examine the cervix for any kind of bleeding. And this is about the process of suction and evacuation. Hope the procedure was clear to you, and hope it is helpful for you in your exams. Please stay tuned to us. We'll keep more such sessions to help you have a visual effect of what we actually do in the operating room. Thank you so much and best wishes from my side.